Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Steve Edelman.
Hey, Steve, you can take the mask off.
Oh, yeah. I'm all by myself. Boy, you get used to wearing these things. My name is Steve Edelman. I'm founder and director of Taking Control of Your Diabetes, a not-for-profit organization that's been around since 1995. I want to welcome you to our very first virtual Taking Control of Your Diabetes conference. Now, many of you have been to a TCOYD conference that we've held around the country for so many years, and nothing really replaces the camaraderie that you get when you're speaking to someone with diabetes, having lunch with them, learning with them. But due to COVID, and we sure hope you're all doing well with COVID, that we are putting on the virtual event. Now, we would have loved to have been there right with you in Omaha today at the Omaha Convention Center. However, because of COVID, obviously, we're going virtual. But the silver lining is that we are now reaching people all over the world, 28 countries and almost every state in the union, if you could believe that. Now, the other silver lining is you could wear your pajamas during today's conference. And I'm wearing pajamas right now, but I'm not going to show you. How's that? And so that's the silver lining. We could reach so many more people, folks that could never even make it to a live conference, and also people from around the world. Now, before I get into my opening presentation, I want to give you an idea of what to expect today. We have lots of sessions planned for you by diabetes experts, that really the best diabetes experts, many of whom have been living with diabetes, such as myself, since I was 15 years old. We got three simultaneous tracks, those for type 1 diabetes, a second for type 2 diabetes, and a third for those of you with type 3 diabetes. Now, what's that? Bill Polansky called all you type 3 diabetes the diabetes police. You're someone that doesn't have diabetes, but you care about someone living with diabetes, and you want to learn about diabetes as well. It's extremely important. Now remember, you could look at the lectures in all tracks, and you can go to any one you want. You don't have to stick to your type of diabetes. And the information will be up for several weeks, so if you miss a lecture, you can go back and watch it later. Now, we also have an interactive virtual health fair where you can go and learn about the latest diabetes resources, products from companies that are really focused and dedicated to helping people with diabetes, such as Lilly, AstraZeneca, Dexcom, and a whole bunch of others. So how do you get to these great sessions and different tracks? Okay, there's three ways. On the confirmation email that you probably received today or yesterday, there is the agenda of the programs and the links to each lecture. The second way is there's an event app that we're using called Event Compass. You could have seen information on a previous email, and if you downloaded that app, you can see the agenda and the links to all the lectures and many other features where you can interact and network with others using the app. And thirdly, if all else fails, just go to our website, tcoyd.org/agenda. So once again, I want to thank you all for joining us today for our first virtual conference. We want you to learn a lot. We want you to really think about specific questions that you want answered. At the end of the day, we want to make you so motivated that you're going to be happy that you have diabetes. I know you're all laughing right now. And so remember, get out your favorite clothing, get out your favorite drink. Put whatever you want in the TCOYD coffee mug. Bourbon is my favorite. If you're not a drinker, please don't start because of this program. Enjoy your day and look out for the next speaker. He is just awesome. Hello, everyone. Steve Edelman again. I am super excited to open up today's virtual TCOYD conference with this presentation, which is going to be a foursome of myself, Drs. Pettis, Dr. Santos, and Dr. Polansky. It's going to set the day for the rest of the conference. And I'm going to share my slides right now. And I'm going to put up my first slide. And we're going to start off and we're going to go. Okay.
there's my opening slide. And normally I have a location, which is Omaha, Houston, San Diego, but there's no limit today. It's the World Wide Web 2020. Thank you for joining. This is our conference room at the San Diego Convention Center last year, just basically half a year ago. We're going to come back to Omaha and do a live program when it's safe. But I want to welcome you once again to today's very first virtual conference that we're putting on. I want to remind all of you that if your questions are not answered, please go to our website. We have three communities for folks, people with type 1, people with type 2, and those with type 3 diabetes. So there are Facebook groups. Now, what is a type 3 diabetic? Well, there is a certain type, and Bill Polonsky, who will be speaking later this morning, has called all of you folks the diabetes police, because you have been deputized by somebody, maybe someone up above, to tell us what to eat and how to eat it. But trust me, you need to be educated as well, and you will become a better partner. And we appreciate you viewing today and learning along with your loved one with diabetes. Now, I don't know if you know this, but animals get diabetes. And I'm going to show you a slide of two seagulls. You tell me which one has type 1 and which one has type 3. Wow, it's amazing. I can even hear you laughing through the computer. I want to give a special thanks to our partners, other not-for-profit organizations that are working in their own ways to help people with diabetes. And I really am happy that we're all working together to spread the important news about diabetes care. A really special thanks to our corporate sponsors. Without their unrestricted educational grants, we would not be able to put on the programs that we do. We appreciate it very much. So what will you experience and learn today? You'll learn online with other people living with diabetes. That's key. Increase your knowledge about important aspects of diabetes. You'll learn about the newest medications and devices for your diabetes. You'll pick up some very important individualized and practical lifestyle tips. Super important. You'll get motivated, activated, and reinvigorated about living a long, healthy, and happy life with diabetes. So embrace and enjoy your virtual experience. Now, all of us with diabetes, we're typically judged by the healthcare profession on our A1C, which is, of course, the hemoglobin A1C. It's that test that tells us, on average, what has our blood sugar been over the past 2 to 3 months. Well, less than 7, you're killing it. And it means you're a good patient. It means that if you check your blood sugar every hour for 24 hours for 3 months, your average would be 155. Now, what if your A1C is above 7? Well, means you're not a good patient. You're a bad patient. And of course, you know I'm kidding, but the reason why TCOID is in existence is because it's pretty darn tough to control your diabetes. Just not that easy to get your A1C less than 7 without a lot of hypoglycemia. Now, one thing you're going to be hearing a lot about today is about glucose variability. That's how much your blood sugar jumps up and down. Now, look at these two patients. The patient on top has the same exact A1C as the patient on the bottom. But the patient on the bottom is doing much, much better, less highs and less lows. And so you're going to hear this phrase quite a bit, time in range. It pertains to not only people with type 1 diabetes, but also with type 2 diabetes. And you're going to hear a lot about that from Dr. Pettis today and myself and some of the other workshops. But time in range is considered to be the percent of time your blood sugars are between 70 and 180. And of course, there's time above range and a time below range. So this is something that tells us how we're doing with our diabetes on a day-to-day basis. The A1C doesn't help us with that. Okay, that should set the stage for the rest of the day. So who should take care of the people with diabetes in this country? Have you ever thought about that? Well, anyone who's interested. And the most interested person should be the one living with diabetes. So the title of today's lecture is The Virtual Diabetes Conference of Tomorrow, Today. Now, this sounds goofy, but there's never been a better time to have diabetes. There's so many new advances. Now, I want to do a quick introduction to our star core faculty, Dr. Jeremy Pettis, director of the type 1 track. He's had type 1 diabetes since he's 15. I've had type 1 diabetes since I'm 15. Then we got Tricia Santos. She's the director of the type 2 track. And of course, Bill Polonsky, the touchy-feely guy. Now, Tricia and Bill do not have diabetes, but you know what they have? They're one of two people who have the honorary diabetes degree. What is that? What is that? It's a degree that says it, you don't have diabetes yourself, but you know what it's like to have diabetes. Okay. Now, the Nobel Prize for the discovery of insulin was 1923. I would tell you the names of these four people, but you'd never remember them. But I want to make a special point. This is one of the greatest discoveries of all time in medicine. It has saved millions of lives. Now, let's go fast forward to 1978, 48 years after discovery of insulin, I developed type 1 diabetes. Now, that's not me, Spanky. This is me. When I was 15 years old, I worked at the Griffith Park Boys Camp in Los Angeles. But the thing that is amazing, 48 years after discovery of insulin, in 1970, I was on the same therapy as folks were in 1923. One shot a day, urine testing, very strict diet. And of course, there were no insulin pumps, pens, there were no newer insulins, there was no A1C kit, there was no glucose meters, there was no continuous glucose monitoring. There was nothing for 48 years, and even after I was diagnosed. But the developments have really ramped up in an exponential manner. It's been incredible. Now, this is an education slide that I was shown when I was a young kid, 15 years old, in my first diabetes class. You know, first of all, they showed the size of the needle. It's huge. Then they showed one type of pill. That's all there was for people with type 2 diabetes. Then look at the diet. Wonder Bread, whole milk, eggs, and canned green beans. Yeah, the apple was pretty good. And look at that piece of roast beef. It's got fat all around the edge. And of course, exercise. This was it. They put all the education together for both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. But you know what? Even though we all have things in common, we are quite different in many ways. There are some of the older names for type 1 diabetes: juvenile onset, insulin dependent. And for type 2, it's adult onset and insulin independent. But these are actually incorrect. And that's why we call ourselves type 1 and type 2. Now, the other thing that's very important for you to know, you can get type 1 and type 2 diabetes at any age. There's Jose, diagnosed with type 2 diabetes at the age of 5. Both his parents had type 2. Both his parents were Latino. And both his parents had weight problems. Believe it or not, Jose weighed over 200 pounds. Then there's good old Barbara and Dave. Barbara developed type 1 diabetes at the age of 64. And so you can get type 1 later in life too. And one thing to remember, we're all blood brothers in a way, because type 1 and type 2 diabetes, you'll learn more about them later, they both lead to high blood sugars. And lastly, believe it or not, you can have both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. That's called hybrid diabetes. And that's a whole different ballgame. Now, what about gestational diabetes? It usually occurs in women. But I can tell you, I had a very tough delivery. Wow. Let me tell you, it wasn't fun. I admire all you women who have delivered kids in your lifetime. Now, what are the important differences between type 1 and type 2 diabetes? I'm just going to go over these briefly because Dr. Pettis is going to talk about them. Misperceptions and physical appearance, incidence and hereditary influences, the causes and prevention strategies, associated conditions, treatment options, and believe it or not, theme song. And that's why we have the type 1 track and the type 2 track. So see the schedule for today and pick out the lecture of your choice depending on your diabetes and your interests. Now, believe it or not, there are theme songs for both type 1 and type 2. Here's the theme song for type 1 diabetes.
is the loneliest number that you ever do.
How about you type twos out there? Here's your theme song.
Two can be as bad as one. It's the loneliest number since the number one.
Is that a great song? Now, there have been incredible advances in diabetes, as I mentioned earlier. Here's a list of advances for both type 1 and type 2. On the left side, insulin, CGM, smart pens, therapies other than insulin. On the right, medications that help with your weight and protect your heart and glucose. All the guidelines have changed, CGM and pumps for type 2. And guess what? We're crossing over. Us type 1s are using some of the type 2 products and therapies, and vice versa. So it's really important that everyone here learn as much as they can about both types of diabetes. Now, traditional medical education goes like this. Research and teaching institutions educate a bunch of healthcare professionals, and then in turn, they take care of people with diabetes. But you know what? It's a very slow-going process, and it usually takes 10 to 15 years for something to be discovered to be finally prescribed for people with diabetes. And I had an idea one day. Let's take the important messages about living a long and healthy life with diabetes directly to the people most affected by this condition. This was the brochure of our first conference in San Diego, September 23rd, 1995, 25 years ago. And we have been there ever since on a yearly basis, plus other cities around the country. So why is taking control of your diabetes so important? Every person with diabetes needs to be an active participant of their healthcare team. So remember these three themes. You have the main responsibility of taking control of your diabetes. You are your own best advocate. Be smart and be persistent. That is what taking control of your diabetes is all about. Help your healthcare professional take better care of you. That's it, right there. So a much more efficient method of information transfer is, you still have the research and teaching institutions, but in a parallel approach, they educate both healthcare professionals and people with diabetes, and there's lots of information exchange between them both. That's important. So remember, glucose control matters. Why? Well, we know that high glucose levels over the years, not minutes, hours, months, over the years, can lead to complications, no matter what type of diabetes you have, eye, kidney, nerve, and heart disease. The other thing that's extremely important today, you're going to hear it in Dr. Bader's presentation on cardiovascular care, that all of us folks with type 1 and type 2 diabetes have to be thinking of the heart. Not only blood pressure, cholesterol, being on an aspirin, exercise, eating well, but also other medications to keep our heart healthy. Now remember, this is true for everybody. Exercise makes up for mistakes. Anybody see anything wrong with this picture? Yeah. Everyone's taken the escalator. This is not an uncommon picture. This is a subway station in Sweden. Honest to God, you can see that what they paint right before people either take the steps or go up the escalator. Anything we can do to stay healthy and to use to burn calories is important. We have to make that special effort. And I tell folks, you don't have to join a gym and go there religiously for a couple weeks right after you sign up after the new year. No, you have to do what you enjoy. If you don't do what you enjoy, you will not continue to do it. Now, what I started doing is I started lifting weights, and you would not believe the transformation. Look at this. This is actually me underneath this shirt. And if you don't believe me, come on out to San Diego, visit us at our TCOYD office. Now, what about my grandmother? Her name is Lucy. She, believe it or not, she started walking 5 miles a day when she was 60 years old, and now she's 101. And you know what? We don't know where the hell she is. Hey, where's the laughter when you need it? I hope you're laughing at home. So what is a diabetic diet? We talked about exercise. There's no such thing as a diabetic diet. There's no magic diet pills. There's no magic diets. There's no shortcuts. Weight loss is difficult. Make changes slowly, small changes slowly, and eat the foods you like in moderation. That's it right there. Now, we have very good dietitians to educate us on the different healthy diets for people with diabetes, but there's no magic. Good common sense. If you want a big cheeseburger once in a while, have one. This is a 5-pound cheeseburger with a bunch of cheese and pickles on top. If you eat it in 1 hour, you get it for free. Now, what about the foods we eat in our society that have so much sugar? This is just an example of the sugar cubes in each one of these products. So I hope you're not one of those folks that say, I can't stand the taste of diet soda, I drink regular. That kills me. There's lots of good diet drinks out there. Now, how many of you have heard that cinnamon is good for people with diabetes? Oh yeah, you see it all the time. I've been eating 3 Cinnabons a day, and so far my diabetes has gotten way worse. So in closing, there are some global issues with diabetes care. First, there's prevention of diabetes and its complications as the first goal. Second, early detection of diabetes and its complications. If you can't prevent diabetes, you can at least pick up complications early, treat them aggressively, nip it in the bud so they don't progress to end-stage complications such as amputations, dialysis, things like that. And third is aggressive treatment of diabetes and the complications. I know many of you hate taking diabetes medications or any prescription medication. You might buy a supplement that may not have any effect at all. When you have diabetes, you've got to treat it aggressively, and that may mean that you need multiple medications, especially for you folks with type 2 diabetes. So diabetes is not a rare disease, and it's not an inexpensive disease. I talk to executives from health insurance companies all the time, and they have their arms crossed. They're turning red in the face. They're saying, if I do everything Steve Edelman says I should do, we're going to go broke. But it really makes me quite angry. So I basically show them a slide that I can get away with because I'd like to give them a gesture, but the only slide I can show is this one. Can't be mad at a cute baby. So remember, it's never too late to take control of your diabetes. And today is the first day of the rest of your life living with diabetes. Please visit our virtual health fair. Gain as much information from the device and pharmaceutical companies that are here to give you information. And please go to our website where you can type into topics A to Z, and a bunch of articles and videos will pop up, and you could really use all the information that we've categorized and stored on our database from being around so many years and being involved with so many great healthcare professionals, many of whom who have diabetes themselves. So take control of your diabetes. You owe it to yourself and your family. Next is Dr. Pettis.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jeremy Pettis. I'm an endocrinologist at the University of California at San Diego. I work with Steve Edelman there, and I run the Type 1 track at the Taking Control of Your Diabetes Conference. But importantly, and probably most importantly, I have Type 1 diabetes myself, and I have since the age of 15, just like Steve Edelman. So this is obviously a new forum that we're using. I'm used to giving this talk kind of in a large crowded room, and you know, I'm probably a little less raggedy, maybe a little bit more clean shaven and have a little bit less hair and probably have a sport coat on. So bear with us as we get through this, but this is an opportunity to reach more people. So I'm gonna introduce you to the Type 1 track for the day. Starting with an overview of kind of what type 1 diabetes is, what are some of the exciting things that are going on that hopefully you can learn about. All right, so with that, I am going to share my screen so that you can see these slides. All right, and I'm going to move Talking Jeremy Head up here in the corner. All right, so welcome to the Type 1 track. And I know you're sitting at home, but this is, you know, kind of what I would poll the audience to see, you know, where the people with type 1 diabetes are at. And I think there is value in getting around people like yourself that have type 1 diabetes that know about the struggles, the highs, the lows, the roller coasters, what it's like, you know, when you go low and then you eat everything in sight and your blood sugar goes to 400 and you take a huge rage bolus and you go down, and you go low again. And that kind of roller coaster that we as type 1s live. So we're looking forward to getting back in person. But in the meantime, there's tons of people online that you can reach out to that have type 1 diabetes just to continue this conversation. So now when we talk about how long somebody has had type 1 diabetes, we've come up with this very important distinction that anybody that's had type 1 diabetes for over 25 years is what we now call a type 1 diabetes legend. And why is it 25 years? Well, it's a very scientific process. We had to go in the lab and do a lot of analysis to figure this out. And it turns out, ironically, that I've had type 1 diabetes for exactly 25 years. And frankly, I wanted to be a legend. And since I'm in charge of this designation, 25 years makes you a type 1 legend. So congratulations. And why is it important to have these type 1 diabetes legends around us? Well, it's important because we can learn a lot from people that have had type 1 diabetes for a while. You know, people that are newly diagnosed, you might be struggling with, you know, all the new things that you have to do. And you can learn a lot from your providers, and hopefully you have a good physician or a nurse practitioner or whatever. But there's a lot that can be learned from the diabetes community. These important things you might not learn in a textbook, such as, you know, alcohol wipes. Do you need them? Do you not need them? You know, I remember when I first, you know, was diagnosed, I would wipe my finger and then prick myself and get that drop of blood and then wipe my finger again. And then, you know, not too long after that, all of a sudden you start using a napkin, and the type 1 legends will show you can just kind of lick off the blood, and they're injecting insulin through their shirts and things like that. So these are important little tips to learn. What about an Omnipod? If it fails, is there ways to MacGyver it to, you know, suck insulin out of it? For sure. These are things you can learn on the kind of the diabetes community that you're now a part of. And what about your continuous glucose monitor? Does it really last 10 days? Well, there's ways to extend it. And, you know, people are definitely walking around with duct tape all around them, and, you know, keeping their sensors on for as long as possible. So these are important life hacks to learn. Remember these things, these sharp containers that, again, when I was first diagnosed, I would carefully put all my insulin syringes in there. And then after maybe a few years, you realize that just an old bottle of Tide will do the trick just as well. And then I started realizing I don't really need Sharps containers anymore because, well, I don't really use lancets anymore. You know, I remember vividly the last time I changed my lancet, and it was Super Bowl Sunday 2017. And there you go. All right. So let me shift gears a little bit and give you a background on you know, some kind of science of what is type 1 diabetes. So we all, you know, kind of have a basic fundamental understanding of the disease that we're living with. So first of all, here's the human pancreas, and we got this blue see-through guy. And the red organ here is the pancreas. And then if I were to blow up the pancreas and zoom in, you know, inside of it, you could see that within the pancreas, there's these small little islands of cells that we call islets. And islets really does mean islands. That within these little islands or islets that make up less than 1% of the total body of the pancreas. So it's just a very small part of the pancreas. Within them are these cells called the beta cells. And the beta cells are the ones that make insulin and ultimately are the ones in type 1 diabetes that are destroyed. And who destroys them? Well, unfortunately, it's our own immune system. So this is supposed to be a T cell, an immune cell, and he's happy and he's got boxing gloves on because he's a fighter. His job is to fight viruses and bacteria and destroy, you know, all the things that it, you know, it thinks are foreign or outside of our body to keep us healthy. But we don't know why. In type 1 diabetes, these T cells all of a sudden think that the beta cells, the insulin-producing cells of the pancreas, are foreign. And it treats them just like it would a virus or a bacteria, and it goes after them and systematically starts targeting them and destroying them. So on my screen, you can see these little X's kind of popping up over the beta cells because it really is almost a one-by-one slow destruction of the beta cells until enough of these cells are destroyed that you don't make enough insulin to control your blood sugars, and your blood sugars go high and people typically go into DKA. And this occurs when you've already lost about 80% of your beta cells. So 80% of your beta cells are being kind of killed silently, if you will. And then it's only when you get down to that last 10 or 20% of your cells that are left that your body can't keep up, and you usually go into DKA. Now, this last, oh, I think I got the T cell saying, whoops, my bad, because, you know, he's not trying to hurt you, but he does. And this important point at the bottom is the natural progression from when this immune assault starts to when you actually get type 1 diabetes to when your blood sugar goes high, it usually takes months and generally more like years. So a lot of times people will say, well, gosh, I got a flu and then the next day I got type 1 diabetes. And they'll think that flu gave me type 1 diabetes. And that's not the case. There's usually some final stressor that kind of puts people over the edge. So you've been kind of hanging on with those last few beta cells making enough insulin, and then boom, an infection comes along that stresses the body, and then it tips you over the edge to making your blood sugars go high. But that final virus or whatever it was, stress, pregnancy is another thing that can kind of bring it up, didn't give you type 1 diabetes. It was just kind of the final straw, if you will. All right. Now, a little difference between type 1 and type 2. I'm going to go through this quickly because Steve mentions this, and other times this comes up during the day. But type 1, I mentioned, is an autoimmune disease. Your immune system otherwise functions completely normally. So you don't need to worry, you know, that you do have an abnormal immune system in kind of everyday life. But in the sense of type 1 diabetes, it's gone awry, and it's an autoimmune disease. People tend to be younger. The average age of onset is about 11. People tend to get it acutely, meaning it seemingly happens overnight, where one day you're fine, the next day you're drinking and peeing all the time, and you go into DKA. People tend to be normal weight, although I'm going to show you that us type 1s, guess what? We grow up, we can eat the same crap that everybody else does, we take insulin, and most type 1s in adulthood are actually either overweight or obese. But when people are diagnosed, they tend to be normal weight. And it requires immediate insulin therapy. Like I said, you usually go into DKA, you need insulin from the jump, and then you're on it for the rest of your life. And this is about 5 to 10% of people with diabetes. So if you took everybody in the world that had diabetes, 5 to 10% of them would have type 1, and the majority, 90, 95%, would have type 2. So in general, when you hear people say diabetes in the news and things like that, diabetes leads to this, or diabetes leads to that, they tend to be talking about type 2 because it is much more common. And type 2, on the other hand, is not an autoimmune disease. It's what we call insulin resistance, where you type 2s, you make insulin, but the tissues of the body just become a little bit resistant to it, and you don't make enough insulin for your body's needs. People tend to be older when they're first diagnosed. It's a smoldering progression, meaning type 1, it happens overnight, you go into DKA. Type 2s, you know, you kind of go to your doctor, they say your blood sugar is a little bit elevated, let's keep an eye on it. Then you might need one therapy and then two therapies. So it can kind of smolder along for months or years. It's definitely associated with people being overweight or obese with metabolic syndrome, meaning associated with high cholesterol and high blood pressure. They all kind of run together in what we call the metabolic syndrome. And we treat type 2 initially with lifestyle and medications, oral medications. And then the majority of type 2s actually will progress to needing injectable therapy, including insulin. But we don't treat type 2s with insulin right from the get-go. And opposed to type 1, this is the majority of people with diabetes, 90 to 95%. All right, so back to type 1. So you can get type 1 diabetes at any age. And why do I have a picture of a pizza here? It's basically because I like pizza. I'm not going to lie. You know, I saw a picture of pizza and I wanted to work it into this talk somehow. So there it is. And it's easy to cut a pizza in half also, even though I kind of did it in a weird way, not along the pre-cut cuts, but bear with me. So half of people diagnosed with type 1 diabetes are kids, less than 18 years old. That's kind of what we call the classic diabetes. But then there's a lot of you folks out there that were diagnosed with type 1 diabetes when you're 30, 40, 50. And it can be missed because people are used to diagnosing type 1 diabetes in kids and used to diagnosing type 2 diabetes in adults. So if you got type 1 when you were 40, they might have misdiagnosed you as type 2. They might have tried medications that didn't work for you, and sometimes it can take a while to get the diagnosis right. So unfortunately, that's a very common situation where somebody can be, like I said, 40, 50, they're misdiagnosed as type 2. It might be a year or so before somebody gets the diagnosis right. So if you are, you know, somebody with type 1 diabetes that got it later in life, that's actually not uncommon, but we're just not that good at recognizing it. All right. Now, most type 1s are the only one in their family with type 1 diabetes. So, you know, I think people think, you know, type 1, that's the genetic one, right? And really not so much. So I love this picture because it says, I'm proud to be the black sheep in my family. And, you know, there's all these white sheep and there's this one black sheep. And then I was looking at this sheep and I was like, this guy's pretty awesome. He's got like an earring and he's got these spiked, you know, wristbands or whatever. So I think that guy's a type 1 diabetic badass. And that's me. You know, I'm the only guy in my family with type 1 diabetes. You know, I think it's kind of the first thing we all do when we're diagnosed is like, did I have a, you know, distant aunt that had type 1 diabetes? Nobody in my family, nobody in Steve's family. That's actually the common scenario of being the only one in your family with type 1 diabetes. So what are the genetics? So, you know, in genetics, the way I'm going to kind of talk about it is, what's the risk of getting type 1 diabetes if a family member has it compared to type 2? And let's just focus on type 1s, and let's go down to the identical twins to start with. So if there's an identical twin set, and one twin has type 1 diabetes, the chance of the other twin having type 1 is about 50-50. So a crude way of thinking that about that is that genetics explain maybe half of the situation, because, you know, identical twins should basically have the same genetics when they're born. But then there's something that occurs in life, some exposure, some toxin, something in the environment, you know, that some virus that explains this other piece, and we don't know what that is. Compare that to type 2, where identical twins, it's about 100%. So it is a very genetic disease. Now, maybe some of the more common questions are, I have type 1 diabetes. What's the risk of passing it on to my child? And the risk is about, depending on if you're the mother or the father, on average, somewhere around 5%. So my children have about a 5% chance of getting type 1 diabetes. The way I like to say that is they have a 95% chance of not getting type 1 diabetes. And I have patients all the time that come in and say, well, I don't want to have kids because they'll just get type 1 diabetes. And that is just not the case. All right. So a little bit about race, ethnicity. This is also different than type 2 diabetes, where the majority of people with type 1 diabetes actually are Caucasian. It can happen in any race or ethnicity group. It just tends to be much more common in Caucasians. We do know that these other racial and ethnic groups, the rates of type 1 diabetes are increasing, specifically in those different populations. So just a kind of fact to be aware of. Now, I mentioned this, but it's good to see kind of graphical information, and so it looks serious and you believe me. Looking at the percent of type 1s based on their age and what percent are overweight or obese. And let's just focus on the adult group. You know, I'm not going to call 18 to 26 adults. So 26 to, you know, above 50. And about 40% of people in those that age group are overweight, and about 25% are obese. So like I said, you know, type 1s, we eat just, you know, like our next door neighbors. We, you know, are prone to gaining weight. And I think, in fact, even more prone to gaining weight because we're injecting insulin. We can get hypoglycemic. We have to maybe eat sometimes that we don't want to. So we tend to think of type 1s as these thin little kids running around. But we all grow up and we can all gain weight. So if you're struggling with weight with type 1 diabetes, you are certainly not alone. Now, what about our glycemic goals? So if we looked at everybody in the United States and we asked the question, how many people with type 1 diabetes are getting their A1C down below 7%, which is where we want them to be as adults? We actually have different goals for kids, so that's why I'm just focusing on the adult population. And our goal for adults is to get their A1C less than 7%, their average blood sugar less than 155 or so. And in the United States, at best, 30% or so of people are meeting that goal. meaning that 70% or so are not. So again, if your A1C is not where you want it to be, it's 7.5, 8.5, 9.5, that unfortunately is kind of the norm. And I think that this data actually comes from, I know this data comes from people that are going to kind of premier diabetes clinics, they have insurance. So the data in the kind of the real world, I think, is actually worse than this. But the point I want to make about that is that this disease is tough. Even for people that are going to doctors that have technology, pumps, CGM, it's hard to get to goal. And I think part of that is just because we don't have the best tools. We could use better insulins and better medications to help out. So again, if you're struggling, you're not alone. But our goal is to get you to this below 7% range. And I love this picture. I had a lot of fun Googling images for this talk, and it just says the struggle is real. Because sometimes living with type 1 diabetes, you feel like this T-Rex just wanting to pick up a burger, and you just can't do it. It's tough. You struggle with weight, maybe. You struggle getting your blood sugars down with low blood sugars, high blood sugars. Thinking about this freaking disease all day long, 24/7, it's an undescribable kind of, you know, the stuff that we have to go through. But cheer up. Hope is here. And just like I Googled Mr. T-Rex trying to pick up a burger, I Googled happiest picture ever. And this was one of the first things that came up. And I just love it. You know, it's just obviously it makes you smile. And I have about a zillion questions about what's going on here. I mean, did the turtle and the dog, do they have a relationship? Do they know each other? Or did this turtle just kind of just hop on this dog's head and he was into it and he was happy? I don't know. I mean, we probably will never know the answers to these questions, but you know, I'm having fun wondering. I'm just staring at that turtle's mouth. I mean, that guy's loving it. All right, so what's the good news? What's hot in type 1 diabetes? I did a little bit of the doom and gloom. A1Cs, they're not where we want it to be, but what can we do to get them where we want them to be? And I have three main kind of categories: new technologies, pumps, sensors, newer insulins, and then other medications to help us get control beyond insulin. So I'm going to start a little bit with the technology and to show you how rapidly technology is improving and evolving in the type 1 landscape. I created this sophisticated chart, and don't take my word for it that it's sophisticated. It says it right there, so you have to believe me. And this is changes to my diabetes regimen over time, starting from 94 when I was diagnosed up to 2020 now. And this is what it looks like, which as you can see is extremely sophisticated. That basically from when I was diagnosed to, I don't know, 2010 or so, things didn't really change. And then every year now, it's like there's something new. It's even hard for me to keep up with. And I love that this chart is going right into my face. Look at it. It's getting me. So that's great. It's hard for even endocrinologists to keep up with this stuff because there's so much happening in the type 1 space. And with these improvements, it is really achieving these two things, not four, two, that we want better diabetes control with less work. And that's what we all want. We want to just live a happy, healthy life, and we don't want to think about diabetes all the time. And that's where technology can help. So when I was diagnosed in 94, this was my meter. And I love that it was called the One Touch Basic. I mean, even then they knew it was crappy and they just called it basic. They're like, it's kind of basic, so let's call it that. It took about 45 seconds to get a result. Usually that result was error. And you had to take off this like thing, like an old computer mouse, and clean it. And it was a pain in the neck. 45 seconds isn't that long, but when you're a high school kid and testing on your desk, it felt like an eternity. 96, a couple years later, woohoo, we got the One Touch. I think this was the basic 2 or something like that. I had a memory function, so that was pretty legit. So now when I was sitting in my endocrinologist's office, I could scroll through it really quickly and fill out my logbook, and then they'd always catch me because they could tell it was in reverse order. Anyways, maybe 10 years later, they make the meter smaller, a little more accurate. It only takes 5 seconds, a little less blood, so that was good. But I mean, that's a decade later, and nothing had really changed. And it wasn't until 2010 that I got on my first continuous glucose monitor. This was the Dexcom 7 Plus. It was a big oval thing, which was great, but only lasted 3 days. It wasn't that accurate. Tylenol would mess it up. So a huge breakthrough, but still room for improvement. And then it was kind of every year. You know, there's the G4, the G4 Platinum, then the G5, each getting like a little bit better, just like a new iPhone where they tweak the camera or whatever it is every time. And then in 2018, for me, came the biggest breakthrough, where I went on the G6, and there's other sensors now, obviously, in the market. But the biggest thing here now is that you don't have to calibrate your blood sugars. So I haven't pricked my finger in months, if not a year, because I trust these things implicitly. I'm getting this on my phone, seeing what my blood sugar is on my watch, just doing all right. I'm not super stoked with my blood sugar, so I'm not going to tell you what it is. So these have been big breakthroughs. And this is the system that I'm currently using now. Tandem has a product called Control IQ that basically it works with the Dexcom G6. So as your blood sugar starts going low, it can shut off the insulin delivery to allow your blood sugar to kind of recover. And then actually, if you start going high, it'll increase how much insulin it's giving you through the basal rate. And they can actually give you little mini doses every hour to bring your blood sugars down into range, which is super helpful. This is something called Loop. This is a do-it-yourself system that does a lot of the same thing that I was using previously. But it's nice now to have a kind of a commercially available product. This Tandem system that I'm on is something that as of a couple months ago, you can get prescribed and get on it, no problem. And these things are really, really good overnight because you're not eating, you're not exercising, you're just lying there. So these systems can give you as much insulin as you need or do not need to keep you kind of in range overnight. So this is my blood sugar the other night, and you can see I kind of dipped low around midnight. You know, the device would have suspended, my blood sugars kind of came up, and then it kept me in range, you know, all the way until I woke up. And then I ate, and then, you know, I'm in charge again, and so everything kind of goes to hell again. So I'm not showing you this to brag that I'm smart and I'm a good doctor and whatever, and my blood sugars are awesome. My blood sugars are awesome overnight because I have a machine that's doing it. So that's a huge breakthrough. We have better basal insulin. So if you guys that are on shots, Traceba, Toujeo, these are much better than Lantus and Levemir because they're much more, they're more consistent. You only need one shot a day. For you people that might be taking two shots a day, they've been shown to have less hypoglycemia. So if you are on shots, you should be on one of these basal insulins. And which one's better? It's hard to say. They really are very comparable. We do have some better rapid-acting insulin. So this is Fiasp that works a little bit faster than our current Humalog or Novolog in terms of kicking in a little bit faster to avoid those spikes after eating. Something to look into. You can put it in pumps also. And then inhaled insulin, Afrezza. I bet you a lot of people out there never even knew there was an inhaled insulin. And there is, and it's been out for a while, and it's very underappreciated and underutilized. This is something I still use occasionally because it works so fast. You inhale the insulin, and it can bring down, you know, blood sugars very, very quickly. It peaks in around 20, 30 minutes. That's versus, you know, our other insulins that peak an hour and a half later. So it really is a rapid onset, and then it's out of your system within an hour and a half. So there, nothing comes close to how quickly this works, and it's something that you should definitely know about. So the last thing is other medications for type 1 diabetes, and this is a space that's still developing. There's only one medication approved for use in type 1 other than insulin, which is called Similin, which isn't used that much because it's another injection and can cause nausea. But we've always been looking for a pill or another therapy in addition to insulin to help people get to control. And there's other medications like Jardiance, Farxiga, Invokana that people have been using for type 2 diabetes for some time now. And there's some evidence that these actually help in type 1 diabetes. So why do I have Homer Simpson here saying I'm whizzing? The way that these drugs work is they actually make you pee out sugar. And when you pee out sugar, there's less sugar in your blood, so blood sugars come down. You also pee out calories, so people lose a little bit of weight. So the data has shown that A1C comes down a little bit, time in a good range goes up a little bit, people lose a little bit of weight, 4 or 5 pounds kind of thing. Blood pressure comes down a little bit. So a lot of positives, but the one negative is that there's an increased risk of diabetic ketoacidosis, which we're still working out how to treat people safely with these medications to get all the benefits without the negatives. So this is about how many grams of sugar you would pee out in a day. Somewhere between 80 and 100 grams of sugar, which is about 400 calories a day that people urinate out when they're on these medications. So stay tuned for that space to see if, you know, these drugs eventually get approved for type 1 in the United States. those drugs are actually approved already in Europe, in Japan, and other parts of the world. So this is not a completely fringe idea. All right. So if you haven't listened to anything I say, please listen to this, because this is an important message to kind of end with, is that type 1s are now living longer than people without diabetes. So I don't know if you're like me, but when I was diagnosed, I don't know if they told me, but at least I knew somehow that, and they did tell me, they said, now that you have diabetes, you're going to live 15 years less long. You know, it was kind of this death sentence. Like, you have diabetes and you're screwed. And we just know now that that's not the case. So this is a slide or a graph that I'll explain what it is. Is they followed all these, this large group of people with type 1 diabetes for 27 years and compared them to people kind of matched for their age and things like that without diabetes to see how long they live. And then they mapped that by A1C. And what they found is that people with type 1 diabetes at about this inflection point is that people that had an A1C of about 8.5, they lived just as long as people without diabetes. As your A1C went up to 9, 10, 11, 12, that's when people did worse. So, but if people kept their A1C below 8.5 in the 7 range, something like that, they actually lived longer than people without diabetes. And I think that's probably because we're forced to be on top of our health, manage our blood sugars, you know, eat better, exercise, etc. So this doesn't mean that you're immune from complications. You know, people might have been living longer but having, you know, some slight problems with their eyes or kidneys or whatever it is. But living longer, and a lot of these people are living completely complication-free. So it's a new day for diabetes. You take care of yourself, even if you already have complications. Take care of yourself. You can minimize those things. You absolutely can live a long and healthy life and do whatever the hell you want with this disease. So, you know, and honestly, I think I'm better off for getting type 1 diabetes. And it's a weird thing to say, but it's helped me be a part of this community, given me you know, part of a focus of my life. So I was going to say I appreciate it. I do. It's a love-hate I have with type 1. So what's the message? Learn as much as you can from these online things. We're so glad to be doing these virtually now. Implement some things that you learn in your regimen. Take this information to your provider. You will have a much more productive conversation if you say, hey, I listened to these lectures, and I want to talk to you about Afrezza. What can you tell me about that? Or what about these new pumps? You can steer the conversation, because you should be the most active participant in your health. Keep up the hard work, and you will live a long and healthy life. And that is it. So thank you very much, and have a good day. Bye-bye.
Hi there, everyone, and welcome to the Type 2 Track. Today, I'm going to give you a brief introduction to type 2 diabetes. We're going to talk a little bit about what's new in type 2 diabetes, and then I'm also going to give you an introduction to things that you're going to see later on this afternoon. So let's get started. I think a lot of my patients feel this way about type 2 diabetes. Kind of, what is type 2 diabetes exactly, and why me? Why do I have type 2 diabetes? So type 2 diabetes, many of you may not know, is actually a problem with insulin. And there's kind of two main problems that people can have. Type 2 diabetes is a problem with insulin resistance. And this means your body doesn't use insulin that well. It can also be a problem of insulin deficiency, where over time, your body's not making enough insulin to keep up with your blood sugars. So insulin's important because it helps your body use glucose. When your body's resistant to insulin, it can't use glucose that well. And so the glucose stays in the bloodstream instead of letting your body use it. And that's when you have type 2 diabetes, when those levels of glucose in the blood become elevated. Now, many people may feel like, why do I have type 2 diabetes? And some people feel a lot of guilt and shame about having type 2 diabetes because they think that it's their fault. And it turns out it's not your fault. Type 2 diabetes is a genetic disease. So you can go ahead and blame your parents, not you. You have inherited genes from your parents, either from one parent or from both parents, that puts you at risk for type 2 diabetes. And it turns out that 2 in every 5 Americans are going to develop type 2 diabetes. So you really aren't alone in this. Another thing that can put you at risk for type 2 diabetes is your race or ethnicity. So there are some races or ethnicities that actually have an increased risk of type 2 diabetes. And this goes back to a little bit of the genetics as well. So again, not your fault, but certain races or ethnicities will put you at risk for having type 2 diabetes. And lastly, obesity can increase your risk of type 2 diabetes. So this is a complicated slide, but I just want you to look at these pictures of the United States. And as we go from the 1990s all the way to 2015, what you'll notice is the rates of obesity are increasing. So the more kind of dark orange or dark red that you see here, that's higher rates of obesity. And what you can see is that over the last 20, 25 years, the rates of obesity have increased significantly, and so have the rates of type 2 diabetes. So obesity is another risk factor for type 2 diabetes. But not to worry, we have a track just for you today, just for all of you type 2s out there. And why do we care so much about type 2 diabetes at TCOYD? It's because over the long term, type 2 diabetes can increase your risk of certain diseases. So one of the most important is heart disease. And sometimes today you'll hear that called cardiovascular disease. That just means heart disease. And we care about this because heart disease is the number one cause of death. Actually, whether you have type 2 diabetes or not, it's the number one cause of death. But type 2 diabetes increases your risk of heart disease. It also increases your risk of small blood vessel complications. So these are kidney disease, which in the medical world we call nephropathy, vision problems, or retinopathy, that's called sometimes, or nerve problems, which is called neuropathy. And all of this can sound kind of depressing to talk about all of these risks, but not to worry, the future of type 2 diabetes is so bright that Steve and Jeremy actually have to wear shades. So there's a lot of great new tools that we're going to talk about today that actually are making type 2 diabetes a lot easier to live with and a lot easier to control. So back in the day, way back in the 1960s and 70s and 80s and 90s, deciding what medicine to prescribe when you were a doctor taking care of patients with type 2 diabetes, it was pretty easy because we only had two choices. You could either take a pill, which was a sulfonylurea. That pill is sometimes called glipizide or gliburide. Some of you may be on that pill. Or insulin. That was really the only two options. So if we look about the number of medications that were available, insulin was the very first medicine that we had. That came about 100 years ago. So insulin's been around for a long time. Then came the sulfonylureas and biguanides. That's actually metformin. And then there was a long period of time where we didn't have new medications. But look what's happened over the last 20 years or so. There's really been an explosion of medicines to treat type 2 diabetes. So now we have all of these medicines, and it can actually get even more confusing for doctors and patients to decide which medication to use. So now when we're trying to figure out which of these 12 classes of medications to use, we ask some really important questions. And these are the questions I want you to ask yourself today as you're listening to various sessions. Do you have heart or kidney disease? If you do, there may be medicines that can be specific for you and help you. And the other question I want you to ask yourself is, do you need to lose weight? The reason is because we have two of our newest classes of type 2 diabetes medicines that actually cause both weight loss and they both protect your heart, and one of them protects your kidneys. So now, not only do we have all these medicines that treat type 2 diabetes, these two classes of medications, the GLP-1 receptor agonists and the SGLT2 inhibitors, can actually protect your heart and cause weight loss on top of treating your diabetes. If you want to learn more about how to protect your heart and how these medications protect your heart, I want to make sure that you attend the afternoon session today called The Heart of the Matter, Cardiovascular Care, or Care of Heart Disease and Preventing Heart Disease. So let's talk about the first class of medications, GLP-1s. These can reduce your risk of heart disease. Traditionally, the majority of these come in an injection, and that can be a little bit confusing for patients because some people think that just because it's an injection, that means that it's insulin. And these medications are not insulin. They're injectable medications that come either in a daily injection, which are the ones listed here, or some of them come in a weekly injection. Can you imagine how easy that would be to take your medication just once a week? And then very recently, we actually have a pill form of this medication. So this is the first time that you can actually take a GLP-1 medication in a once-a-day pill. Now, how do these work? GLP-1 is a hormone that everyone makes in their gut, and it's a hormone that you make whether or not you have type 2 diabetes. The GLP-1 medicines work the same way as this hormone, and this hormone does a lot of fancy things around your body that help you with your diabetes. So the first thing that it does is it helps your pancreas secrete more insulin. It also decreases the amount of sugar that's made in your liver. It turns out sometimes your liver can make a lot of extra sugar. GLP-1 also keeps food in your stomach longer, so it can kind of slow down how fast your stomach's emptying. So it keeps you full longer, and it tells your brain that you're full. So these medications can lead to weight loss because it's really decreasing your appetite and keeping you fuller for longer. Now, there is a kind of a cool newer technology with these medications. So in other countries, this is approved. It's not yet approved in the United States, but there's this little micro pump that's about the size of a matchstick that can be implanted underneath the skin, and it can deliver a GLP-1 medication for 6 months. So that means you can have a little procedure in the office, have it put in under your skin, and you don't even have to think about taking your medication for 6 months, which is pretty cool. So hopefully one day that will be approved here too. Now, the second class of medications that I talked about that can help your heart is the SGLT2 inhibitors. These not only help your heart, but they can slow the progression of diabetic kidney disease. So I have this little heart here and this little kidney to say, go heart, go kidneys, because they actually protect both. These are a once-a-day pill, and their names are really a mouthful. They're tough to say. Dapagliflozin, canagliflozin, empagliflozin, ertugliflozin. But these medications really have many benefits, including protecting the heart, protecting the kidney, and even causing weight loss. So how do these medications work? It turns out that your kidneys work to filter all of the waste products in your body. And one of the things the kidney does is when the glucose gets into the kidney, it holds onto it so that your body can use glucose. These medications, the SGLT2 inhibitors, actually make your kidney get rid of glucose. So they take glucose in the kidney and they put it into the bladder and out into the urine. So in short, it makes you kind of pee out your glucose. And the amount of sugar it makes you pee out per day is about this much in this hand, if you look at all these sugar cubes, a huge amount of sugar per day. So these medications not only make you pee out the glucose, but they protect those heart and kidneys and cause weight loss. Now, we have new guidelines from the American Diabetes Association that tell us how to use all of those medication classes that I was talking about. And this graph is really complicated. I don't want you to look at the nitty-gritty of it, but I want to give you a summary here of what those guidelines say. Those guidelines say that those new classes of medications that I was talking about here, the GLP-1s and the SGLT2s, are the first choice for patients to take with type 2 diabetes after metformin. So we all know metformin is the best medication to start with to treat type 2 diabetes. But after metformin, if you have heart disease, if you have diabetic kidney disease, if you're overweight or obese, you should think about starting with a GLP-1 receptor agonist or an SGLT2 inhibitor, because these medications can give you extra protection or cause weight loss. If you're at risk for hypoglycemia, these are also good medications because they don't cause low blood sugars. You can also take a DPP-4 inhibitor or a TZD if you're at risk of hypoglycemia. But it's important to remember that if cost is an issue, and this is an issue for a lot of the patients that I see, these medications are more expensive. So we still do use sulfonylureas and TZD medications. So that would be Actos or Avandia, if you have cost as a major issue. Now, we do have some combination of medicines that's making life a little bit easier for type 2 diabetes. So I told you that the newer GLP-1 medicines come in an injection, and we have two medications available that actually combine an SGLT2 inhibitor with a basal insulin, a once-a-day insulin injection. So the nice thing about this is you can have one pen here, and you can use one single pen and one single injection to get two medications. So Soliqua is a combination of insulin glargine and lixizenatide, which is a GLP-1. And Zultify is a combination of insulin degludec and liraglutide, which is a GLP-1. So really cool way to be able to take one injection and get the benefits of two medications. We also have newer combination pills to treat diabetes and make life easier. There's many, many combination pills available that combine two different types of pills for diabetes. This is the newest one that was recently FDA approved, Trijardi, and it is the first one that combines three medications in one pill. So this has an SGLT2 inhibitor, empagliflozin, linagliptin, which is a DPP-4 inhibitor, and then metformin. So I think these can definitely make life easier if you're, if you want to take less pills. Many people have, tons of pills, 10 to 20 pills to take a day. So it can make your life easier. But again, if cost is an issue, taking the pills separately works just as well. I do want to introduce you to a newer feature for type 2 diabetes, which is continuous glucose monitors. And there's a session this afternoon on this, continuous glucose monitors, or we call them CGM, for type 2 diabetes. So if you're interested in this, please attend the session this afternoon. There's two systems that are available mainly for type 2 diabetes, the Dexcom continuous glucose monitor and the Freestyle Libre. And this is where you wear a little glucose sensor on your body. This one's on the stomach here, this one's on her arm here. And these can check your blood sugar without pricking your finger. So no more finger sticks. You can check your blood sugar with your phone, have it look, your blood sugar show up right on your smartphone. Some of them work with a smartwatch as well. And you get to wear these devices for 10 to 14 days at a time. You can shower with them, you can go in the water or the pool with them. So they're really making life easier and also giving us more information about what's going on with our blood sugar, what happens when we eat certain foods or do certain activities. So I encourage you to attend this session later today. They're also, Dexcom is working on even making these smaller. So you can see this is the current size of the Dexcom continuous glucose monitor. And this is a prototype for what the future generations are gonna look like. Really small continuous glucose monitors, which could be disposable as well. And the last thing I wanna give you a heads up on today is that we are holding the largest shared medical appointment for type 2 diabetes. And this is, I think, one of the silver linings of going virtual with our conference, because normally today we would just be in Omaha and serving the great people of Omaha and having them all come to our conference. And because we're virtual, we get to have so many more of you type 2s joining us today. And we're gonna hold a medical appointment for all these type 2s in one. So really, it's going to be a historic moment to have such a big appointment for so many people. So I hope you'll attend that today. The message that we want to send you for type 2 diabetes is that there is so much hope. There's so many options, including medications and other tools that you can use to not only improve your diabetes, but make your life easier. So really, it's your turn to learn, to educate yourself, so that you can be the co-pilot with your doctor for type 2 diabetes. I hope you all have a great day and hope you come back and see us virtually soon. Thanks.
Hi, everyone, and thanks for joining us. My name is Bill Polonsky. I'm a diabetes psychologist. I'm president of the Behavioral Diabetes Institute. I'm also an associate clinical professor at the University of California here in San Diego. I've done nothing for the past 30 years except had the chance to meet many, many thousands of folks living every day with diabetes and learn more about some of the issues and challenges they go through and how they've managed to be successful. And it's why I want to talk to you today about the emotional side of diabetes. So let me begin by sharing my slides with you here. Let me make sure I can pull those up. And okay, so as you can see, we want to talk about the emotional side for everybody, for those people who have type 1, type 2, and as Dr. Edelman talks about, people with type 3 diabetes, those of our loved ones. So to talk about this issue, there's so many things we could talk about, but I really want to really kind of limit it to my 5 most important lessons that I really want to make sure we touch on and that you all feel comfortable with. So here they are, 5 lessons, not more than 5, that we want to go through in order. So the first lesson, probably the most important one, is I want everyone here to know that if you've ever had any kind of difficult, challenging aggravations about diabetes, you're normal. Here's some of the things that we know. First of all, we know that if you've ever struggled with depression, that's pretty common. We know that about somewhere between 8 to 10% of people, perhaps even more, have gone through times, or are actually going through times now, where they've been really discouraged and depressed. So depression is common, and it may be more common in people with diabetes than people who don't have diabetes, although that remains controversial. We know that if you live an everyday with diabetes, many, many folks, again, somewhere about 8 to 10%, have significant problems with anxiety. And perhaps the most important finding, which is in the bottom of this slide, is that lots of people are really go through times when they're very, very stressed out about their diabetes. In fact, if you look at the percentages, you can see that's way more common than having depression or anxiety. About 1/3 to as many as 40% or more of people living every day with diabetes feel really significantly stressed out. And we call this phenomenon diabetes distress. And here's some illustrations of what we mean by that. See if any of these fit your own experience, either now or in the past. People tell us, starting at the top left, you know, this disease just takes up too much of my mental and physical energy every day. I feel like I'm failing with this regimen. I feel like this disease controls my life. I feel like my friends and family aren't supportive enough of my self-care efforts. Or at the bottom of the slide, many people say, I feel like I'm going to end up with serious, scary, long-term complications from diabetes, no matter what I do. And if any of these sound familiar, you can see why that would really drag you down, and it makes it harder to manage diabetes. And we know these feelings are common. Again, somewhere between 1/3 to 40% of folks really struggle with elevated levels of diabetes distress. And it goes well beyond just these illustrations. If you've gone through times where you've been angry about diabetes, discouraged, sad, confused. Again, we know this is normal. In fact, one of the most common ones was a great illustration sent to me by my colleague, Carrie Sparling, who's a famous type 1 diabetes blogger. And she says, here's something that I go through all the time. This for her represents, as I'm sure it does for many of you, this real struggle of feeling discouraged and overwhelmed by this disease that despite your best efforts, oftentimes diabetes doesn't cooperate. You can get high blood sugars, low blood sugars, sometimes your weight's up, sometimes your weight's down, and it feels like despite your best efforts, this is happening. And this feeling of, I don't know what I'm doing sometimes, all these can be real drags on the system and can lead to people saying, I'm not even sure why I keep staying engaged with my diabetes. And we know that's actually a big issue. So for example, here's national data. This is from what's called the NHANES study. And this is a busy slide, but I'm just gonna focus on that blue bar on the far right that I just drew a circle around. That what you see there, that's actually 25% of people with diabetes in this country, type 1 and type 2. 25% who are reaching all 3 of the major ADA treatment targets. Their A1C, their blood pressure, and their cholesterol, especially their LDL or lousy cholesterol, all of those are in a safe place. That means that 75% of people are not in a safe place, 75% of people with diabetes in this country. So if you feel like your numbers aren't as great as they need to be, welcome to a big club. Lots of people are struggling. Sometimes it's because of the fragmented healthcare system, or they can't afford their medications, or things that don't have anything to do with their own oomph. But in fact, a lot of it can have to do with your own diabetes self-management. And that relates to this emotional side, because we know that managing diabetes can be tough. So why is it so tough? Why are so many people struggling around taking their meds, trying to make positive lifestyle changes, What's so hard about this? Well, first, let's look at some of the myths. Many people think, well, maybe it's because you're not scared enough. That's why you're not managing your diabetes well enough. Or maybe it's because, you know, you're stupid. Or maybe you're just lazy. And oftentimes this is what how other people might think about folks with diabetes. And sometimes you might even think this about yourself. And it comes down to feeling like, maybe I just don't have enough willpower. That's why I'm struggling with all the tough work of managing this disease day to day. But I'm here to tell you, none of this is true. It's just not true. What's true and why managing diabetes is tough is what I want to show you and talk about what's on this slide. Here's the most important thing I want to tell you. I promise you this is true. When it comes right down to it, you, me, everyone we know, everyone would prefer to live a long and healthy life. No one's unmotivated to want to live a long and healthy life. Not anybody. The problem is this. Diabetes is a job. It's a demanding and it's a time-consuming job. I mean, think about it. Think about when you were first diagnosed. The day you were diagnosed, what happened is the universe just said to you, congratulations, I have a new job for you to do. It's going to be a fair amount of work. There's no pay. There's no vacations. And oh, by the way, you get to do this for the rest of your life. Who wouldn't get tired of that over the course of time, especially if it is a job? And it's not an easy job, which is the third bullet point on this slide. It's a balancing act that can also be challenging, right? Because as you see in this image here, you don't want your blood sugars to get too low or too high. Maybe you should lose some weight, but not too much. You should be, you know, focused on engaging with what the tasks of diabetes are, but you also need a break sometimes. And how do you find that right balance for you? And oftentimes this job of diabetes is so tough. Again, not because you don't have willpower, not motivated, but because you have a lot of other things to worry about in your life. Because the bottom line is life gets in the way. If you're like this family, where they have a lot of other responsibilities that are taking priority, I got to make sure I feed these kids. They don't wander out into traffic. I got to make sure I don't lose my job or I got to find a job. It's understandable that the demands of life can get in the way of managing diabetes effectively. So if that's been true for you, again, you're normal. Doesn't mean we can't address this, but it means it's common. That's the second lesson. The third of the five lessons I want to mention to you has to do with the fact that most people don't know about all the good news about diabetes because we focus so much on the bad news. So you've heard plenty of bad news. You've heard about all the terrible, scary complications that can develop if you have diabetes. But do you know about the good news? Let me highlight that if I can with just a couple studies I want to mention to you, because we now know it's the 21st century. The bottom line is this, with good care and effort, odds are pretty good you can live a long and healthy life with diabetes, and that a lot of these scary, scary complications actually may not happen at all. So let's start with type 1 diabetes. After living with type 1 diabetes for a long time, let's say 30 years, if we had a big population of people with type 1 diabetes, what percentage of them would have run into the scary, scary complications? So one research group did that, and here were the results they found. And I'll explain to you what's on this slide. On the left side of your screen, they found that in this population of people with type 1, about 30% of them, that's that bar on the far left, 30% already had suffered severe vision loss or gone blind. In the middle column, they found that more than 10% already had significant amputations. And over there on the right, well more than a third of these folks already had significant nephropathy or kidney disease. Many people, when we share this slide with them, they go, yeah, that's about what I expect happens to people with type 1 diabetes after they've been living with it for 30 years. Except maybe you've noticed there's something peculiar about this slide because it says 1978. That's the year this study was published. 1978. This is really, really old data. Yeah, this is probably what was possible in 1978. But this was a time when there was no such thing as an A1C test, no such thing as glucose monitoring. We didn't have any of our fancy, cool insulins. We had nothing. We didn't even really know that good care could matter. But what about nowadays? So let's look at another example of another study done much more recently that looks at the risk in a big population of people with type 1 diabetes who've lived with diabetes for 30 years And nowadays, here in the 21st century, what percentage of them have run into the same scary complications? Now, to be fair, the group I'm going to show you is not normal. This is a group of people who have had really, really good care. They've been pretty engaged with their diabetes over this whole 30-year time. But this is what's possible. So after 30 years with type 1, this is their risk at the rates of developing complications. So in this group, it wasn't 30% who had severe vision loss or gone blind. It was 1%. And last time we looked, back in 2009, nobody had gone blind. Amputations, not 10, 12%, 1%. And nephropathy, it wasn't one-third of the sample who had developed kidney disease. It was, 6, 7%. So not perfect, but pretty extraordinary in terms of what's changed over the course of these years. Now, this is no guarantee, but this is what's possible. With good care and effort, odds are pretty good you can live a long and healthy life with this disease. But I know, that's type 1 diabetes. What about type 2 diabetes? Well, let me show you a recent study. This came from Sweden, where what they did is they compared a big group of people with type 2 diabetes, in fact, everybody in Sweden with type 2 diabetes, more than 250,000 people, about age 60 or so, and they said, let's look at what happens to them over a six-year period. And especially they looked at a couple things. We're going to look at heart attacks. And they said, let's compare whether or not these people had heart attacks compared to people who were similar but didn't have type 2 diabetes. Here's what they found. So first of all, the people who didn't have type 2 diabetes, the rate of having had a heart attack, that if you will, the number or percentage of the people who didn't have diabetes who had heart attacks is represented by this blue bar. Don't worry, it's about what's on that axis to the far left. But this is basically the percentage of that group that had a heart attack. Now compare that to the people who had type 2 diabetes, that really tall blue bar. And this, again, may be something you've heard before, that people with type 2 diabetes are triple, quadruple the risk for having heart attacks compared to people who don't have diabetes. Now, the only problem with this is that I'm lying to you, because that big blue bar actually wasn't the people in the study who had type 2 diabetes. It was a subset. It was people with type 2 diabetes who also had all the five major risks. And what that means is they had elevated A1C, so they were in an unsafe place with their blood sugars, elevated blood pressure, elevated cholesterol, elevated albumin, which has to do with their kidneys, and just to make it more interesting, they were smokers. So yeah, if you have all these numbers elevated and you're smoking, your risk of having a heart attack, way up there. But what about people who didn't meet any of these criteria? What about people with type 2 diabetes who had their A1C, blood pressure, lipids, and albumin all in a safe place, and they weren't smokers? Well, their risk of having a heart attack, the percentage of that group that had a heart attack, is this little blue bar on the far right. In fact, that little blue bar on the far right, type 2 diabetes, is somewhat smaller than the people who didn't have type 2 diabetes. And this suggests, again, something remarkable, that, again, with diabetes, with good care, you can do pretty well. Again, I summarize it as clearly as I can. The evidence here in the 21st century is this. No guarantees, but with good care, odds are pretty good you can live a long and healthy life with diabetes. We should all have hope that you can do well. And that's why you're here. That's why you want to put effort into managing this disease. So that's lesson number 3. Here's lesson number 4. I want to talk about the secrets to behavior change. Now we know so much a part of diabetes is about stuff you need to do. But positive action might be needed, but what to do when, if you're one of those people, when it seems like all of your choices sound bad, right? Like maybe you're thinking, oh, these medications I'm supposed to take are bad for me. Or maybe you're thinking, what does it mean to be eating well with diabetes? Probably just means I have to eat birdseed or cardboard. Or maybe you're thinking, oh my goodness, exercise, that's just gonna make, what a chore, it's gonna be painful and embarrassing. In fact, diabetes care itself just feels like it's just gonna take too much time. So the first thing we have to consider is that all these common beliefs people have are beliefs, but they're blinders we're wearing because actually none of them are true. And that's one of the reasons why you're here with us today, taking control of your diabetes, to learn about some new things and to help to understand many of those beliefs are just wrong. Think about some of the actions you need to take when you're to manage diabetes effectively, whether it's making positive lifestyle changes, whether it means even taking your medications. Think of them as vitamins that work, actually, because these are the steps you can take that can help you actually live a long and healthy life with this disease. It's how we think about these things that are critical. And I hope you're going to learn a lot more about that at the event here today. So what I want to encourage you all to do, based on what you hear, is to think about one specific action you might want to take, whether that means asking my doctor about a new medication or taking my medications better or making some positive dietary change in what I'm doing every day or becoming more physically active. But prepare yourself for taking a leap, making one new change. And if there's one really primary secret to behavior change that we know, is don't overwhelm yourself. You don't have to change everything. We can do it one step at a time. And that's what's critical. Think about that one change, one step at a time, change at a time, one small change in how much physical activity you take. And we can build on that over the course of time. That's how people can be successful without overwhelming yourself. Now, the final lesson, the fifth lesson I want to mention to you is this. If you really want to be successful, if you really want to find the oomph to manage diabetes well over the course of time, we have to talk about the power of pals, because it means don't do diabetes alone. When you have people in your life who are rooting for you, who care about you, diabetes is just easier to manage. And it can be anybody. It can be a friend. It can be a family member. It can be anyone. But it can make all the difference in the world. And of course, that means getting the right kind of support, because you don't want to have people rooting for you too much. It's doing it in the right way. So you want to reach out to the people in your life who care about you. And if they're acting like diabetes policemen, you know, those are the people in your life who've decided that God has deputized them to help you manage your diabetes with you, whether you like it or not, you can talk to them and say, look, you're nagging me too much. You're bugging me. I know you care. Let me give you some ideas about the best way to support me with this job of diabetes. And then think about, how do I, again, make use of their support, my loved ones, better? And if that's not too possible, think about making a new friend in the neighborhood, maybe someone who'd like to start becoming more physically active with you together, or join an online group with people who, other people who have diabetes, who will really get it and understand. There's so much power in the support we get from others in our lives. And this whole idea of just making some new friends is a powerful way to get the oomph and support that you need to be able to get on board and get on track with your diabetes and do really well. So those are the five lessons. I hope they've been a helpful first start for you as you think about really getting on track or staying on track with your diabetes. And I want to thank you all for listening. And we'll look forward to hearing more from you throughout the program here today. Thanks.
Hello, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this morning's opening session. My name is Michelle Feinstein, and I'm honored to serve as executive director of this great organization. Our mission from day one has been to educate and motivate people living with diabetes to take a more active role in their health. And here we are today, 25 years later, still spreading the good news that you can live a long and healthy life with well-controlled diabetes. And even though we are all having to adapt to this post-COVID world, that message of motivation and education is just as important, if not more so, than ever before. Which is why at TCOYD, we are working to increase access to diabetes education, healthcare resources, and community support in areas of need. We can't do what we do without the support of our corporate sponsors and private donors, to whom we are very grateful. And we are hoping that you too will consider supporting TCOYD so that we can continue to help people living with diabetes and their loved ones deal with this lifelong condition. You can support TCOYD by going to our website at www.tcoyd.org and donate. It is so nice to meet many of you virtually from across the United States and the entire world. Stay healthy, and we'll see you at our next conference.